Good morning, everybody. Thank you for the organizer, for the opportunity to be here with you and to discuss about split and organ engineering. I come from the Rome Bambino Gesù Children's Hospital, and I'm a transplant surgeon in charge of the abdominal transplantation and hepatobiliopancreatic surgery over there, where we have a pretty active liver, kidney, and pancreas transplantation program. And other colleagues today will have some talk from our hospital. So the two topics of my talk could be different, but actually they are about the same topics. That is how to face the donor organ shortage, and how to improve the outcomes and to be able to have one graft for the whole life. And we already heard this morning how the improvement of surgical techniques along the whole history of organ transplantation made it possible to increase the number of transplantation, but also the immunology improvement that we had between the 70s and the 80s was very important. And nowadays, regenerative medicine is an option that is offering a lot of possibility in order to increase the number of transplant and how we can do that and which kind of outcome we're going to have with organ transplantation. So the first part of my talk is about organ split. And when we talk about split, of course, we think mainly to liver, to split liver transplantation. But if we expand this concept and we think to the transplantation of partial organs, of course, we are talking also about lung and pancreas, and we'll touch a little bit this issue later. So split liver transplantation, of no doubt that this kind of technique was mainly applied and has a very important crucial role in liver transplantation. And this is because we still have a significant mortality of our pediatric patient in the liver transplant in the liver waiting list. These are the data from the UNOS, and as you can see, the mortality is still between 10 to 15%, with some class of age and of the dimension of our recipient that are particularly disadvantaged when they are in the waiting list, when they need a transplantation. And actually, if we only use whole graft coming from pediatric donor in Italy, as I said before, pediatric donors, that means age below 18, are preferentially allocated to pediatric recipient. These are only 4% of the whole population of donor. We might have some split graph also from pediatric donor. I will touch this a little bit later. But the most important part of our donors comes, our graft for pediatric recipient comes from adult donor. And those that are splittable are about the 20%. Of course, we can also have, and we use actually living donor, and we obtain partial liver from parents, and this helps in the goal of transplanting all the children in needs for transplantation. So, what is split liver transplantation? Is the division of a whole liver in two different parts. One that is usually the second and the third grafts that represents about 20-25% of the whole liver and gives enough volume to transplant the larger part of our pediatric recipient that are small babies weighing usually below 20 kilos. And with this graft, we can obtain an ideal graft-to-recipient weight ratio that is usually between 1.5 and 3%. And the other part of the graft, usually represented by the extended right lobe, segment 1 and 4 to 8, is about 70-75% of the whole liver. And this can be used in an adult recipient with pretty good results and no difference in the outcome compared to the use of a whole liver. And actually, if we look at the data coming from the European Transplant Registry of the pediatric liver transplantation activity, we can see how the introduction of partial liver transplantation significantly increased the number of transplantation performed, and how split liver represents about 70% of the pediatric liver transplantation activity in Europe, even if in the last years we have a constantly increase in the number of living donor liver transplantation also for pediatric recipients. What you need to implement in an efficacious way a split liver program is to have criteria in order to decide which donor can be splitted, and an allocation policy. And an allocation policy that has to be implemented nationwide, because you can also split liver in the same center, transplanting both the graft in the same center, but you will not end up in diffusing this technique. And what you need, you definitely need, is a split liver allocation policy. We actually do not have universally accepted splitting criteria, but what we know is that usually you are looking for a young donor with a short ICU stay, with low needs of inotropes, and no or mildly a modification of the liver function test. And using this donor, you are expecting and you will have good outcome, good transplantation results. We have few anatomical contraindication to split liver. The main one is a rare anatomical situation in which you do not have the extrahepatic bifurcation of the portal vein. And this is an anatomical situation that do not allow to split the graft. And sometimes you might have a very small, very hypotrophic left lateral segment that are rarely that rarely you can use. We started to use split liver transplantation in Italy since the end of the 90s, and along the time we adapted our split policy. And in the last year, we ended up in defining a mandatory split liver allocation policy. That means that nowadays, all donors that are aged between 18 and 50 years and they have a standard risk, they are primarily offered to a pediatric liver candidate unless there are in the waiting list an adult urgent or an adult recipient with a MELD score over 30. In all the other cases, the donor is offered first for a split liver transplantation. And adapting this policy, we were able to significantly reduce the pediatric waiting list time. Nowadays, our waiting time is about 3 months and a very short few days for an urgent transplantation. And in this way, combining the use of split liver and living donor liver transplantation, we almost eliminated the wait list mortality. The mortality is very low, and this comes mainly from specific cases of combined organ transplantation. And actually, our split liver transplantation rate is reaching about 10%. This is significantly higher, for instance, of the one of the UNOS data. As you can see, after the introduction of this new allocation policy, the percentage of split liver significantly increased since 2015. And what on the daily work means that we have a very increased number of offers, that it's about one donor every two day offered to a pediatric program for transplantation. And this is important because it allows us to choose the best donor that we are going to split. In terms of outcome, what we were able to show, and this is consistent with the data published from other countries, is that the results are very good. Above around 95% patient and 90% graft survival, no matter what kind of organ are you going to use, split or whole graft. And as I mentioned before, also the results of the use of the extended right graft in the adult population did not differ from the transplantation of a whole graft. Split liver can also be performed in pediatric donor. This was one of the first cases that we did many years ago. So you can split a pediatric donor and use both of the graft, the left lateral segment and the extended right graft, into different pediatric recipients. And we did not only document the feasibility of this technique, but we also show with a multicentric Italian study that the results are very good. Also, when you use the right extended graft in small adults recipients. The technique of split liver can be further modified in order to obtain different grafts with a different size. If you do the modified split liver technique, you end up in having a left lobe that is about 40% of the whole graft. And this is the smaller one of the two that can be used in a small donor, in a small adult or in an adolescent recipient, again, improving the number of pediatric liver transplantation. And usually the right part, the left hemiliver, and that is the biggest graft, can be used in adult recipient. This technique has not been utilized as much as we would like, because mainly of technical and logistic reason, but it offers an important possibility to further increase the number of the graft that we can use for liver transplantation. We are in the last year we have an increasing number of indication to pediatric liver transplantation because of metabolic diseases. In these cases, we have very small recipients without ascites, without big liver. So sometimes the use of left lateral segment from a split liver, it's too much in terms of the size. So especially in Japan, they developed several techniques of further reducement of the size of the left lateral segment. And they were able to obtain and to show very good results also with the use of a monosegment from transplantation. And they were all able also to define different techniques that allow to reduce the size of the graft, not only laterally and ventrally, but also in terms of the thickness of the graft. That this is very important in order to be able to close the abdomen directly and not to have a compartmental syndrome and vascular complications. And finally, A partial graft coming from a split liver can also be used for auxiliary liver transplantation. This is a fascinating technique that was mainly developed in the UK in King's College, and especially for acute liver failure and for some metabolic indication. This technique theoretically offers the possibility to transplant a partial graft, leaving part of the native liver, and after a while to be able to withdraw immunosuppression as far as the native liver recovered from acute liver failure or the partial graft can offer sufficient metabolic activity in case of a transplantation performed for metabolic diseases. So, in conclusion of this part of split liver transplantation, as you can see from our experience, if you use all the different transplantation technique, all the different kind of graft that we have available, you are able to perform a good number of transplantation with good results in terms of patient and graft survival, and with no mortality in the waiting list. And this is in the mind of a surgeon, a transplant surgeon remembers a left lateral segment. And I think that naturally is suggesting that we have to use this for transplantation. As I mentioned before, we can also think that we can split graft when we have two grafts. So as you know, for lung transplantation, we can also perform not only double lung transplantation, but single lung transplantation in order to perform two transplantation from a single donor with comparable results. And also in the field of living donor, and again, this is coming mainly from Japan, from the East, you are also able to use two donors to get two lung lobe to perform a living donor lung transplantation. This is an early experience, but again, it's a very good demonstration how we can use partial graft either from cadaveric or from living donor, as well as the possibility to perform living donor segmental pancreas transplantation. This technique was rarely applied so far, but again, it's another possibility of use and transplant partial grafts with pretty good results. And if we documented how we can improve the number of transplantation with the technique of partial of organ splitting, graft engineering will be in the next years what will help us in order to respond to the organ demand and to eliminate the waiting list, to have a theoretically inexistable source of a transplantable organ, to be able to induce tolerance and eliminate the need of immunosuppression, and also to transplant graft significantly reducing the ischemia reperfusion injury, and in that way improving the outcome of transplantation. And what regenerative medicine offers is the possibility of organ regeneration, organ repair, and these are mainly related to the use of perfusion machine that I'm not going to touch today, and also to the possibility to manufacture whole organs with the use of biomaterials, living cells, and biochemical factors. And this can be done mainly with two different approaches, with the ex vivo, where you are going to decellularize organs and to infuse cells, or you can use, and we will be able to use in the future, the three-dimension printing technology, or in vivo, with the possibility to use techniques of interspecies blastocyst complementation. The first step in organ engineering was the understanding of the importance of the extracellular matrix. What is now clear is that the extracellular proteins structure plays a very important role in the determination, differentiation, proliferation, survival, and migration of the cells that we are used then to create the new organ. And actually, in this part, in this first step of organ engineering, many progresses have been already obtained. As you can see, they were able to decellularize very different kind of organs. Also, as you can see here, a face, a hand, a tract of the trachea, and many different organs that are usually then transplanted. The second step after the decellularization is to put new cells in this structure, and this is the area where we have to obtain much more improvement and much more results. Different cells have been used, like fetal cells, porcine cells, embryonic stem cells, or induced pluripotent stem cells, using the bioreactor technology to infuse these cells in our decellularized graft. Moreover, what we do have as a possibility now is also to intervene into the DNA of the cells that we infuse, and in this way being able to modify the genetic profile of the cells and of the organ that we are trying to build. But for sure, this part of the research, the recellularization of our scaffold, are the one that is going slower so far, and where we need much more more data and more results. Even if many results have been already obtained, like in the heart field, where they were able to perfuse and decellularize rat hearts, and then after that to infuse endothelial and myocardial cells, and in this way they were able to obtain a new contractile heart with the possibility to have a pump function under physiological stimulation and fluids load. And also with the less complex tissue like the trachea, they were able to recellularize the scaffold and then to transplant the trachea in some patient. But anyway, in the organ transplantation field, this area needs much more improvement. This is a paper from an Italian group where they were able to demonstrate that the in vivo recellularization is not functioning so far, and also the ex vivo in vitro infusion of cells has some limits in terms of recellularization of the vascular structure and proper migration of the cells into the scaffold. And these are, as I mentioned, the fields where the this activity needs much more experimental results and improvement. Another fascinating possible application is the use of this extracellular matrix in order to build up organoids. These are a nice video that gave me Professor Orlando from the Wake Forest, where they put islet cells in these organoids, and this can really, after the infusion, function as islets in order to control and to treat diabetes. In the liver field, we still have problems, and we need improvements as the liver has many different type of cells, and when we infuse stem cells, we still have problems in order to have the proper distribution of the different type of cells in the scaffold that we obtained after the cellularization. And again, like in the kidney field, many questions are still waiting to be answered in terms of which cell type are the best to be used and how we can obtain a proper organ and functional structure. The use of the 3D technique, I meant at the end, of the 3D technique, printing technique, is another fascinating possible application where we can simultaneously build up the scaffold and infuse the cells into it. So, in conclusion, the growing number of patients in the waiting list need the possibility to have alternative source of organ, like split organs that, as I show you, they can come from deceased donor, but partial organs can be obtained also from living donor, and this is going to be a very important pool in order to increase the number of transplantation. And for sure, the further development of regenerative medicine will be in the future the most important area where we will be able to improve our results. Thank you.